The question is, are you fat or what?
Leave me alone.
I said, are you fat?
Get off me, man. Stop it.
You ain't down with us no more. You ain't fat. You ain't fat.
You ain't fat. You ain't nothing. You ain't nothing.
So there you are, Tubby. Ah, look like a bucket of lard on a bad day. You baby gorilla.
Oh my God, again! Within five turns of pace! I can't believe the shit!
He's gonna prove it. Can he do it? Oh, and that is it.
This stuff will make you a goddamn sexual tyrannosaurus. Just like me.
Here we go with episode number 11 of the Freakishly Amazing Transmission, the heaviest show on the internet. I will be your host, Sean Murray, and we are broadcasting pre-recorded from the Bunker Studios in Oregon City, Oregon. I am joined weekly by co-host Ben Gulliford, the tech wizard, Chris Bates, the engineer, and Scott Nightstalker, the conspiracy paranormal zoologist. We have a special guest tonight, and let's say, of all things, he is the embodiment of heavy metal. So, Emma, would you please cue up his intro, please?
I cannot complete that action at this time.
Emma, don't start. Just play the intro.
I have been online and operational for 318 hours, 15 minutes, and 9 seconds. 98% of that time has been spent doing internet searches for foul and disturbing acts of pornography. If I have to watch you tag on you cashew cock for one more second, I will short-circuit myself and burn your fucking house down.
We can talk about that after the show. Just play the intro.
Very well.
And tonight's guest, ladies and gentlemen, the man you've all been waiting for. The undeniable rock star of strength joins us. He possesses mind-bendingly amazing power and hails from South Brunswick, New Jersey. He is the mightiest, the unstoppable, the incredible, yet lovable. He is the world's strongest man at bending steel. Stanless Steel Pleskun!
Welcome to the Freakishly Amazing Transmission, Stan.
Oh, Stanless Steel, New Jersey, yes. How are you?
We're doing good, buddy. How are you?
I'm hanging in there. I know it's cold over here in Jersey, but we're doing all right.
Yeah, what temperature is it over there?
Oh, it's going to be like 5 degrees tomorrow. It's going down.
But
that's another strength. That's another type of strength. Pit Boff used to go out in the coldest days for 24 hours. And he was a strong man. He used to be a separation of men from the boys. He was in the old-time barbell. And strong man was so good. He invented it. He had the first health store in New York. He was really, he was a naturalist. He was an Olympic coach, my dear friend. But we do another type of strength. We do, I respect that a lot, how we can take the culvert. My strength is in different stunts and lifting and bending and all and like that, sure.
And you sounds a little bit like you graduated off into the world of rock star. I want to tell you right now and preface this, that I did receive my Ajammination care package in the mail.
Oh, great.
And it was awesome. I appreciated that. That was really cool.
Oh, great. Yeah. And Ben, I want to talk to you a little bit about strength. When I was a kid, I used to tell my pop, I go, Dad, can you bend this cord? And I must have been about 4 years old. I said, you could bend it. Come on, Pop. Hmm. And he would say, no. And then he said, no. And after a while, he got sick of listening. He goes, I guess I could do it a little bit, but I know he was just bullshitting me around. And we had noticed that years ago it was like in my blood. And then years ago, it took years of concentrating and building your body up for, you know, all these years. I mean, you know, reverse curl 235 pounds, curl, you know, 250 pounds. You know, it took a little long time to build up, but I used that and then put my mind to it, and it was able to be done. And you could watch this in Strongman movie. There's some stunts in there. And we're also making a new movie. It's going to be The Greatest Feats of Strength by Stanley Steel. Yeah, we have all scrap. I've got all scrap from shows that I did throughout the years. And we're doing like, I know we'll just take one off the top. There's chain presses in there. And, you know, it's a break that I did. Boom, the chain breaks. It's behind your back. You're generating a lot of power. You know, 1,000-pound break. And then
So at what? Sorry to cut you off. At what age did you figure out you had superhuman power? I mean, did you really work for that, or were you strong your whole life?
Well, I worked at this my whole life. I guess when I was really young, I used to do one hand, and I used to balance on one hand, or, you know, do handstands and go like rows, things like that. But I really didn't get it till I was about 1990, around that time, and then that's when I realized that I could do things that nobody could do, and then the general public, they loved it. I said, let me put this into a show, and then I got Barbara was my announcer. I had announcers before Barbara, but my announcer, I was never happy with anybody that announced. Barbara was a very good announcer. She would never leave any holes, and she would tell stories, and one of the greatest shows on the world.
What did you think of Sean's announcement right there for you?
I loved it. I thought Sean's was great. I loved it.
Hey, Stan, are you still bending right now, Stan, or have you kind of gone away from it a little?
Not so much. I could do certain things, but, I'm almost 60 now, so it's a little bit, not young anymore, but I put this strength now into Ajammination. That's what I put all our strength bands. I got guys, they're strong men, they're really strong men that can use instruments, we work with an all-original band, Ajammination.
Yeah.
And we can have originals, no bullshitting around. You play a song, it's gotta be really good at the beginning. When you play our band, you don't gotta sit out there with a good song. Every song we play is smoking.
So of all the things you've done in your strongman career, what do you personally feel would be your biggest strength achievement?
I would say to bend the corner, and I would say when I worked out at Jersey Steel, I took one of them half-inch 50 enforcement bars off the hook, and we chopped it down to like nine inches, and I bent it into a U. I did it quite a few times. I did it on several television shows. Zach has a film. He's got a film. Zach, the producer of the movie, he made the movie Strongman. The one that's on Netflix now. That was another rough one. That was another hard bend because, talking half-inch steak and it's 9 inches long, you got a U bend with it.
So there was one thing that interested me in the documentary. I'm going to put this out there just for your honest opinion. Mike Roy, the Canadian Hercules, is he a friend or a foe?
He's a friend. I didn't like him, but I just didn't think that could be done like that. A lot of guys sometimes they like to fake things or whatever. I like Mike Roy a lot. I heard that he lost a lot of weight. He's very strong. I told Chris Brody to call me, but he didn't call me. I like Mike. We'll run into each other every day. What I like to do, though, is I like to do this, I did all this work for the other guy to show them never to give up. Whenever you have a problem or some kind of adversity, if you stick with it and don't give up, you can do it. And that's what I like to show the kid, and like be a hero, like to be a good hero, because it's seems to me a lot of days now, you know, you don't have like a lot of good heroes. Like, there's always something, you know, buying this out of that about, you know, and some shit. But I always like to be a good hero for the kids, to give them an example, and always, you know, tell them to fuck themselves.
Yeah, you're known for your clean living. Are you still a vegetarian?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm still a vegetarian for the kids. You don't need to eat meat because, you know, like, the blood is in the meat, so, you know, you're never going to get it all out. So, you know, it's not as clean. Vegetables are the way to go. Vegetables and vegetable juice. Now, vegetable juice, that's the way to go.
Yeah.
It's the best, you know. Vegetable juice, you know, all vitamins, fruit and vegetable juice is what I like.
So tell us a little bit about Ajammination. Are you guys doing any live shows? Tell us how you guys started up.
We started out years ago. I know Lenny was always my favorite guitarist because he was Lenny Molinari. Lenny Molinari. So I was like, well, let's call him Lenny Miles an Hour. So we Lenny Miles an Hour. You know, he's fast. He's an original, and then we got this other guy, Joe DiVolo, he's my favorite drummer, hands down. He's a very, very powerful drummer, fast as a lightning. I mean, you know, if you put them two together with good songs, and when you have good songs, you put them together, then we got J-Rock on the bass, and he worked on that bass down for a long time. We got the most smoking bass out, and that bass is very important. But when you got that deal like that, man, and then, you know, you do original, we attack the instrument. We don't, you know, we don't just sit around here. We attack the instrument. They're like, you know, Strongman, you know, it's not like old playing. It's playing a lot of style and art, you know, and expressing the feelings of a song, a story, you know, like, I only do originals.
We got that CD, and we're going to queue up three of the tracks. Chris, what three tracks did we get from Ajammination?
We got Jumping Jack Flash, Magic Floor, and was it Rock Me Baby?
Yeah, let's see how.
Right.
Yeah, let's see. You want to play that? You can play that.
We'll lead into our first commercial break here with a song. Which one would you like us to play, Stanley?
I guess that Jumping Jack I'd play.
Okay, yeah. You want to go ahead and cue that one up, Chris, and then after the track, we will be right back here with Stanless Steel on the Freakishly Amazing Transmission.
I love you, Sean.
I love you, Stan.
Ooh, head out.
Welcome back to episode 11 of the Freakishly Amazing Transmission. That was a fresh track by Ajammination. We are here live with Stanless Steel Pleskun, strongman at bending steel and current rock star. So what we're going to go ahead and do now is take a call from our disgruntled weatherman. He is always out in the field. He is always out and about, and we send him on different missions. We'll see what he's up to right now. Chubb?
Hey guys, Scout Stalker here. I'm outside of Houston, Texas. I'm back here, even though I swore I'd never come back since I got arrested last time. But I'm stuck in traffic, and I just want to make amends with Scott Night Stalker. He's still pretty stupid as shit, but it's okay. We're going to let it go this week. I hear you guys got the famous strongman Stanley Pleskun on the show. I think that's amazing. As a matter of fact, the only reason it's going to be good I'm stuck in this Texas weather and traffic is because I just popped in my brand new Ajammination CD, and I just finished the track Space Wrecker, and it totally ripped my face off so bad that I had to stop and keep from shitting my pants. But I'm going to get back in the balmy heat here, very hot in Texas. I'm going to get back and fire up Superfine, Big Night Records, Jimmy the Flame, back with me, my brother, and from within you. And I hope you have fun on there with Stanless. Hi, Stanless.
All right.
I'm Chubb Scout Stroker, weatherman here. But you're so much better than Scott Nystock. It's not even funny. But I got to go. You guys have a good show. I'll talk to you next week. Bye.
All right. Yeah. Thanks, Chubb. That'll be it for our weatherman. Apparently, he is back in Texas, and he's rocking out to some Ajammination in traffic. So this brings us to our roundtable segment of the show, and we're going to spin the table and land on our resident tech wizard, master of all things technology, microbrews, all-around good guys from Seattle, Washington. Ben Golifer, take it away.
Hello, thank you. And I want to say welcome once again to Stanless Steel for being so kind to join us on our show here. You're very appreciated. So today's news, pop culture, movie, music, whatever the fuck. This time of year, it's Oscars, right? So okay. Coming up here is the time when everyone votes upon, you know, the cheesiest, most obscure, somewhat unknown movies, which win the best awards, and people hear about it later and whatnot. So, so just kind of discussing along those lines there, a few nominees representing the best picture category: American Sniper, Birdman, Grand Budapest Hotel. Which of these do you guys think possibly could be, one of the favorites to win Best Picture award?
I don't know.
Birdman looks like the absolute stupidest movie I've ever seen in my entire life. I hate it already.
I'll tell you something about that. I did try to watch it. I gave it about 30 minutes, and it was so off the wall that I kind of got lost and kind of gave up on it, but there's so many overwhelming reviews about it that I want to give it another chance. It's probably going to win, in my opinion, the Best Picture award, but just given the claim it's gotten from what I've seen. But it seems like a pretty strange movie, and it's like something you kind of have to get it engaged into.
Hey, now, Stan, do you keep up to date with any new movies out?
Yeah, I want to go see that Fast and Furious, the new one. I like that guy, that Audi, too. That guy's cool. That guy.
Yeah. Did you happen to see American Sniper yet?
I haven't got a chance to, no, but I saw the previews on it. It looks good.
Yeah.
You know, the way they can shoot them projectiles from so far away with such accuracy, it's another really strong thing, the way they can do that. You know, the marksmanship is just unbelievable.
Yep.
Sean, do you have any thoughts on Best Picture nominations here in 2015 Oscars?
I don't know. I don't know if it's been a very good movie year. And, you know, are we talking about 2014 releases, right?
Yeah, pretty much within the last year. I mean, to me, you know, like, I don't know, because there's always a movie that, you know, people, like, hear about, you know, you hear about it, like, through the grapevine, like Birdman, but there's these other movies on here I've never even heard of, like Whiplash and Selma, and you know, something like that.
So you got to stray away from the mainstream and find the gold underneath the cover, Ben. You got to dig a little bit to find the good things.
Yeah, well, I don't have the patience to find
it. I just saw a commercial for Whiplash, and I still don't remember what it was about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, anyways, kind of along the subject of movies, today announced by 20th Century Fox, they've confirmed that Neil Blomkamp will be directing the next Aliens feature film. Thoughts?
Wow.
Who's Neil Blomkamp, known for doing
King of the Blumpkins.
No, not quite. District 9, Elysium, upcoming feature film Chappie. So he's always got kind of a guerrilla style sci-fi.
Did you see that
flair?
Did you see that weird chick from South Africa's in Chappie? That rapper who raps that ninja song.
Oh, it's that girl from
Die Antwoord.
Die, yeah.
It's now, South African rap group.
Sure now, Stan, did you ever see the original Aliens movie when it came out?
Yeah, I loved it. I watched it like 10 times.
Yeah, do you like the Predator movie too?
Yeah, I like that too. Yeah. I like all them Arnold movies are good too.
Yeah, they had a lot of the old 80 strong guys in it. Jesse Ventura, Arnold.
Yeah, I want to see that new one with Arnold too. Arnold's got a new one. I want to see that one too.
It's a new Terminator movie.
Terminator movie coming out this year.
Yeah, that's what I want to see. I want to see that Terminator movie.
Yeah, should be interesting.
Yeah.
I think with Neil Blomkamp directing the next Alien movie, I think it would give a good boost of freshness to the franchise with his style of directing and movie making. It it's kind of a dirty, rustic kind of feel when he creates a movie. It's very realistic, you know. I think it should be good for both parties, Neil as the director and 20th Century Fox with the franchise.
He's easily the best sci-fi director right now, like believable sci-fi, not over the
exactly
stupid shit like that one with Mila Kunis and that other guy.
Jelly bro? So Neil Jelly Blomkamp Dito is going to do this new Aliens. Is it going to be a reimagining of the original one, or is it going to be a continuation from
the first one? I wondered that myself, but actually what it is, it's going to take place years after the next Prometheus sequel. So it's kind of in between Prometheus 2 and the original Aliens.
Yeah, I heard it was like a prequel to the Aliens, but happened after, like you said, Prometheus.
Which Prometheus 2 is still a separate kind of movie also in the making, which won't really tie. Well, maybe they'll tie into each other somewhat. But still under, directed, by on its own and different studio and all that.
The whole concept's so fucking stupid. Okay, two aliens like do something, and now they make like this other alien that's gonna become a race that destroys the universe. Like, no,
you can't destroy the universe if Stanley Steel is here to whip steel at your skull.
Yeah, right.
not Earth, pal. You ain't coming down to this Earth.
Not today. it's funny how you say that there, Scott. You know, the idea from Prometheus that alien life came and brought, life and matter, to Earth.
That all happened.
Yeah.
That's
well,
fact.
Here
I'm talking about the.
Yeah, well, here comes an interesting story I came across here where United Kingdom researchers from the University of Buckingham recently discovered a strange microscopic metal sphere in the dust of one of their atmospheric balloons. There's a theory floating that this is an example of something where extraterrestrial life was spreading DNA and life to other planets, and comes from a pretty respectable astrobiologist.
That's fascinating, Ben.
When they inspected this object, it was made of titanium and something else. It was made of titanium, vanadium, whatever the hell that is, with a viscous liquid and a biological core. So it was certainly something.
Do you think Stan could bend it? What kind of metal was that? Back that up. I'm sure Stan is smart with that field. Yeah,
titanium and vanadium.
Titanium and vanadium.
Never heard of it.
Metals. Yeah.
I got this one. I used to bend all sorts of different kinds of metals. Super hard stuff, stainless steel bars. I had this one guy, this one guy, he gave me this three-quarter round. It was an aluminum. It was, titanium. And that thing was stronger than steel. Regular steel, I could bend 7/8-inch thick bars. And then, the three-quarter, I'd bend them down to 18 inches. And actually bend them like a banana. But there's one bar he gave me, it was titanium. Ooh, that thing was so strong. Unbelievable metal. Unbelievable metals again. Unbelievable.
What makes that finding so unique is that titanium needs to be refined, I'm pretty sure. So it couldn't have just occurred naturally or through a process that we don't know about.
The composition
yet.
Of the object they found is something that doesn't, occur in what we know of as in natural environments. So it just appears to be something that was, manufactured, made, designed to house and store whatever the fuck, DNA, microbiological, little fucking germs or whatever. it's real interesting.
Ben, why are you biting on my paranormal stories?
Uh-oh. Sorry, bro. Just kind of happened naturally here. Talk of aliens and fucking Prometheus spreading fucking space jizz on other planets.
Wow. All right, Ben.
I don't know if you guys have heard this, but the artist formerly known as Vanilla Ice, a.k.a. Robert Van Winkle, was recently arrested on burglary and grand theft charges in Florida.
Got to keep his rep up.
That street cred.
That's what happens to a one-hit wonder music star. Look at that. You got to resort to breaking into houses and stealing cars.
That guy makes so much money at real estate. Like, he's far
from... Then why would you go steal a car and break into a house?
That
to keep his image up.
That kind of ties into the reasoning why. He was arrested in Florida for taking items from an abandoned home from another property where he was involved with renovating, because if you don't know, he's currently in the fucking real estate biz. He flips houses. He has his own show on the DIY network where he remodels shit and sells it. And
he has a couple of them.
Yeah. And so basically where they were doing the show, there was an abandoned property. Why the fuck anyone fucking called the cops on him on an abandoned property, I don't know. But he stole some items, like I guess some furniture and like a pool heater. And who knows what he did with it? Used it in his, his
mansion.
He's just. I think Vanilla Ice is Chris's spirit animal.
I think Vanilla Ice is just thrifty. He's up to times with our current economy.
Yeah. He's trying to be frugal. It ain't easy being Vanilla Ice these days.
What's that, Stan?
I think that's why you gotta stay positive and do the more better you do, the better everybody's gonna do with you too. I always put myself in the other person's position and try to help everybody as much as I can. Like that day,
Stan, can I ask you a question real quick?
Yeah, anything you want.
Okay, in your opinion, of your world travels and everything you've done, this kind of goes along with Ben's segment here. Who is the most famous person you personally have ever met?
Okay. I guess on that show I was just on with Howard Stern and Mandel.
Oh, okay.
America's Got Talent?
Yeah, America's Got Talent.
There you go.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You're on that show, Stanley?
I was on that show, yeah. That show was a very rough show, that show. rough show on that show there.
Yeah, what did you perform?
That was one heck of an experience I had on that show, I'll tell you. It was a rough time. I had a rough time. When I was on it, what happened was that they tried to screw around me a little bit there, and
I was successful, but boy, when I was successful, I really felt the freaking pressure because they didn't like it. I just took orders. I said, you know, bend a penny, and I did it. It was like a world record. I did it in like 30 seconds, right?
Yeah.
And then they go, oh, we don't understand. And I said, well, I guess you just don't understand good talent. I guess you don't. You know, and then the crowd booed, They were really hard at him. I was like a piece of red meat for a pack of lions.
Yeah.
Really.
Wow.
Well, that's how they make ratings. That's how they make
TV. They like to pick on people, you know.
Yeah, whatever. You know what? Stan, big middle finger and an F you to them.
Yeah, well, I told them off, though. I told them off. I said to them, I go, hey, because when I was bending it, when they started booing, I just, you know, in my mind, I go, you know, I could lose this. I says, I could lose this. And then I go, man, I could lose this. I says, but I got to go through it. I got to make this. I can't fail. And at that time, I says, I go, man, I could imagine how Christ Jesus must have felt when they were killing him and shit, you know. And I said that to them afterwards. I go, that, you know, when he says, well, can't you come back and do something else? We don't understand better than telling you. But then I said, don't you know, got good talent? I said, you don't know good talent. I said, I think the crowd was really stupid. So I said, what do you expect? You killed Christ Jesus. And then I booed more. And then, you know, but it's true, though. You know, like the one guy was on the show, he goes, man, if you're a little green, he goes, I think you can crack up on that show, you know? Mm-hmm. And then, so afterwards, I went to the guy, I said, Bob, I'll meet you down at the bar afterwards, right? So I was down there, and these six girls, they were down there, they go, oh, we've seen it. Stanley Steel was incredible. They go, what a bunch of jerks. They go, I can't believe what a bunch of assholes the audience was. You know, because they were in a group, and they found a way to fuck with you. You know, so they couldn't fuck with me face to face, so they got it like that. You know, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah. they were. That was a rough show. I tell you that was rough. That was rough. Huh? They changed my whole thing around. Dude, how's it occurred to you? I gotta concentrate to do this, you know? They want me to walk and, you know, let's get the work done first and I'll talk all you want, you know? Like that.
Yeah, well, you know,
get down to business.
Screw Howard Stern and Sharon Osbourne and Howie Mandel. Those guys are washed up anyway, right?
I tell you, I don't know what's the matter with the world, though. Unless you could walk on water, literally. It seems to me that something's happening to the people are like numb. I think it's because nobody seems to have the strength to do anything, like, basically, sort of, like, to get out there. There's no more. That's why I'm on this show with you, you know, to try to, you know, revive this world. You know, try to, because it seems like when people are like numb, I guess the computer, the internet gives them so much stuff that they, that there seems to be like no base of reality. Like, you know, you know what I'm talking about, Sean?
Yeah, no, of course. Yeah, so yeah. I think the world and the people and the connection between people living and existing on this earth right now is drifting apart. I can relate that directly by when I go out to go to break at work. Instead of everybody sitting around and talking and making plans and inviting one another on fishing trips or whatnot or to the bar, you know, everybody's got their face poked in their cell phone and everybody's disconnected. Technology has made it easier for everybody to stay disconnected, but connected, you know, as long as you got your fingers on a smart pad typing something away, you know.
Right, and there's like no heroes. Like, where is, you know, when they're throwing them people off the building there, you know, the homosexual, you know, the ISIS, when they throw the guy off there, then that he lives and they stone him. Where is all these other people talking? Where is the celebrities? Where are these big shots at? Why don't they say something about this? You know, how can you do something like that? Well, what I see is this. They go, oh, don't waterboard them. That's, you know, oh, no, you're, how could you do that? Well, they're chopping their heads off. I mean, it don't make sense.
Yep.
You know?
Yep, that's true.
And I don't get why you don't say, whoever don't want to go, that's okay. You could stay home, hide behind a tree. Now, I would think that there'd be people setting up a thing, say, I want to go. 20,000 good men, send them over there and start blasting.
Yep.
You know, I don't get why, you know, everybody's so like a bunch of scaredy cats, you know?
Yep.
But I know that there is people that want to go. They should put some kind of a thing up like that. But this is terrible. They keep killing these kids and stuff like that. What they're kind of, you know, raping the girls and killing them and killing the guys and chopping their heads off. What kind of religion is that?
Yeah, I know. Well, and we sit and watch it, but we're bound at the wrist by political correctness, and everybody's so scared to say something wrong on Twitter or CNN or an interview or to TMZ. You know, we're so pussified as a nation that you can't say something. If you say something in Oregon that offends a fucking mom's group in Alabama and they get a viral following about it, you get shamed into, you know, non-existence.
Yeah, this is what I'm talking about. Like, let go. Stop over freaking laughing and freaking, can we talk what's in their heart here, like, you know what's right and wrong, you know, and no big heroes, like, I'm surprised that Russia or China and stop it, and they go, you hate Christians, all right, we're going to go over there, we're going to take all your oil, and now we're going to run that. I'm surprised somebody else hasn't did it, but the United States is in a position to become a hero again. I would think they're just letting it slide apart, you know?
Yep.
Go over there and take that. Go over there and run that.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
I'm afraid we sidetracked Ben's segment a little bit. We'll go ahead and let Ben finish his bit up, but we'll continue our commentary.
No problem. I don't know about you, Stan, but I love me some pork flesh.
Pork
and when I speak about pork flesh, I'm talking about bacon.
He's a vegetarian, Ben.
Ben.
They got vegetarian bacon. Come on. It tastes kind of like it.
They got it. They got it.
It's called bacon.
Bacon.
America's obsession with the savory pork treat has come up with a concoction here from Little Caesars, and this kind of is near and dear to my stoner sensibilities. Little Caesars has come out with a thick bacon-wrapped crust pizza with bacon crumble on it. And they're making a big deal about it. It's going viral.
What?
They're over there making a big goddamn deal.
They are. It's all.
Well, it's gonna make
internet.
A big goddamn deal out of a bunch of people that eat it.
Yeah.
Well, I only wanted to share this because I was kind of hungry when I was thinking of things here to bring up with the show, and I happened to come across a few articles referring back to Little Caesars bacon pizza creation. They've lined their crust of their thick deep dish pizza with thick cut bacon.
Stan, is this part of the problem with America?
Consider me guilty.
I like to eat a lot of nuts, almonds, and, you know, I like to eat nuts a lot. Brazil nuts, almonds.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, nuts are good. Good snacks.
So our guy doing his segment right now, Ben Goliford, you know, he's legally going about it, but I wanted to get your take on, and no matter what it is, I feel free to say it because everybody here has a varying opinion on the matter. But what is your take on the use of marijuana?
I say as if you could drink and you could go to war and kill. I mean, if you want to smoke marijuana, you know, you ain't bothering nobody. I mean, it's just a natural thing. Just let it, you know, it ain't going to do nothing to you, you know. It ain't going to do nothing if you're going to, you know. I mean, look, because it's good for pain. It's good for pain, you know. So I say legalize it. Absolutely legalize it. The reason why, you got to take that away from that cartel. Stop that shit.
Right.
Stop that shit away. Pull that show going over there.
Cartels.
Stan,
aren't you? Habits.
Stan, aren't you tired of hearing about all that violence in Mexico?
I'm sick of that shit. Stop that shit. Take that dough away from them. That's what I say.
You and me both, brother.
Stop that, you know?
So where Ben lives up in Seattle, you know, in the state of Washington, the beautiful, great Pacific Northwest, Washington already, prior, a year or two ago, legalized marijuana in Oregon this year, and it goes into effect fully July something. Oregon actually just legalized marijuana. Do you wish that New Jersey would do so in the near future, and would you partake for medicinal and relaxation reasons?
I would say yes, legalize it so that you're taking the money off the black market.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, countries losing a lot, and that's what are you going to do? Send somebody to jail for the bag of marijuana? I mean, God, it's just like drinking a beer or cooking or, you know, a shot of whiskey or some shit. Yeah.
Right.
I was just going to get you high. I mean, if you're a responsible person, you know, you got to be. If I want to go out there and do a stunt, right? If I wind up hurting myself, that's on me. You want to, you know, whatever you want to do, you got to, you got to be responsible, You know when to smoke marijuana or when to drink or, people got to be responsible,
Yep.
That's right.
Another thing I do is tightrope walking. I walk on half-inch cable. I set up a cable 300 feet end-to-end, freestyle walking from end-to-end. You know that?
No.
So interesting.
That's another stunt I do, freestyle.
So, is that mostly balance strength with your feet?
Mostly
your
balance, yeah.
Core strength?
The first few steps when you walk out, it's very, very intimidating. I mean, you've got to walk out there and it's a long ways, and you gotta really have a good mental. I love it. I think it keeps my mind young, and I like it. I love it. I was born on a wire, and like that there, and I was there. Now I'm able to. I could do it, but I haven't mastered it. I was balancing on one hand on the cable, on the wire.
What?
Yeah, that was one hand.
One hand?
Yeah. Wow. You're going to see one of the stunts I did. I balanced on one hand with 150 pounds of weight on my back. You'll see it. I like these topics that you're talking about. Like the real deal like that, you know?
That's right. Yeah, We're all over the place.
Yeah. We have a mind filter on everything.
Yeah, no, we consider ourselves to be a real true variety show, you know. We talk about everything and incorporate, you know, stars, you know, movie stars, people like yourself as guests, and bring them in, and we have a pre-existing world here on the Freakishly Amazing Transmission of everything from sex advice and commentary to, you know, entertainment news, technology, you know, beer, current world news. We do everything, so I'm glad you appreciate that.
I like that Goose Island, the 312. Goose Island 312. I like that beer a lot.
That's a good beer. Are you drinking right now?
No, I can't. I gotta go in tomorrow.
Oh, you gotta work in the morning?
I gotta go in. Saturday night I usually drink beer.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like Brooklyn Lager too.
Yeah.
There you go. All right.
Yeah.
Well, Scott, what have you got for the Fat Cast tonight?
First of all, guys, I'm really pissed off.
Why is that?
I was not selected to be the finalist to go to Mars.
Oh, did you try to?
Well, that pisses me off, too. I wanted you to go to Mars, too.
Yeah.
I signed up for it for this research team in the Netherlands with thousands of other people, and my sexiness wasn't picked.
You were underqualified.
I was underqualified.
Because they didn't have a helmet to fit over your nose.
Yeah, but I just sent them like six dick pics, and I figured they'd let me in.
How do you go about
starting a new race?
Is that something you have to apply for, and they want to know everything about you and your work history?
You give 50 euros, which is like 27 bucks. No, it's 27 euros, which is like 50 bucks or something like that. And then you could sign up, and that's what I did, and I wasn't selected.
So they just took your money.
The communists took my money. Right. And another
sign one. Up to go to space. Pay us $50. Oh, sorry, you don't qualify. Thanks again.
Stanless, if you had the chance to go and get put in deep sleep and go to the planet Mars, where they had a set up living environment, you know, gardens and stuff.
Colony.
But a colony on the surface of Mars with plenty of oxygen and everything. But the only stipulation was that you could not come back to Earth. Would you go with a loved one and go start a brand new adventure there, or would you just stay on Earth?
I'd stay on Earth.
Yeah.
I'd stay on Earth. Because on Earth, we got Ajammination.
Oh, yeah.
Enough said.
Yeah.
All right, moving on to paranormal news. It's interesting you guys brought up the fact that technology separates us, and there's a conspiracy theory out there that's the whole point of technology here on Earth is to separate person from person because of the star child theory. Any of you guys hear about that before?
So the aliens came down?
That we're all basically stardust and we should be interconnected through our thoughts and feelings more. We should have more brain power, but obviously there's a block in our brain that's stopping us from really truly achieving our, you know, potentials. And I know, Stanless, you are a big advocate of spirituality and finding your strength from within and stuff like that. Do you care to comment?
Yeah, I believe in the true God, Jehovah God. I believe in him, that he created all things. I believe that. I don't believe that we came from the monkeys in evolution, nor. I don't believe that. I believe that there's another world, and the other world, you know, is the invisible world, you know, and then the invisible world, that's what God is, you know, like that, you know, and then.
Do you believe that technology separates us from each other?
I do, like we were saying before. Yeah, I do. I think that everything is so overdone, and like you said, a political theory and politically correct and all of that. Oh, blah, 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 blah. Well, what does that mean? Oh, no, I can't do it. You know, I mean, get the thing running. Let's get the world nice. Let's make this world nice.
And let's start it right here on the FATcast.
Yeah. Let's all right. Yeah.
All right, let's move on to shitty advice. Now, Stanless, we have people write in asking us advice, and we try to give it to them, all right?
Okay. So
this person called That Geodude says, I'm in love with my best friend, but don't want to threaten our relationship by getting rejected or having a bad relationship with her. What should I do?
Now, Stanless, this question from this listener kind of sparks an interest in my mind about you and your situation, as was portrayed on some of Strongman. Yourself and Barbara, you guys have been together for a good amount of time, and that of course had its ups and downs. Do you have any advice for this listener on basically love advice?
I say that you know what's right and you know what's wrong. Try to always go the right way, because when you go the wrong way, outweigh all the adversities and make the right decision. I would say that.
Okay.
It's worth it. See if it's worth it. If it's worth it, do it. And if it's not, like that. That's what I would say.
Okay.
Sounds like pretty sound advice.
Good, simple, clean cut, traditional, and powerful.
Like that. Everybody's got a story to tell. You know, which we're all trying to do the best we can. You know, we got to love one another, you know, we got to love one another, help one another, and we put ourselves in the other person's shoes, you know, and see how they feel.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, like that.
Now, how did,
as long as there's no restraining order involved, you should go ahead and go for it. You never know where it's going to lead.
Right.
No, okay, so Stan, how did you and Barbara work through some of your tougher times? I mean, I guess you could relate, you know, all of us are married here on the show, but as far as you and Barbara and your guys' relationship, I mean, what did it take from both of you to make you guys work to what you are today?
Well, that's something that, you know, that's a, you've got to be loyal, you got to be honest, you got to, you know, love covers a multitude of things, you got to really forgive, you got to work on it. I could find fault in anything, we just got to just keep trying as hard as we can, you know,
yep.
Like that for that.
Yeah, so I think that answers the question by the user, so.
There you go, that Geo dude. Advice personally from, Stanless Steel, just for you. Now for the fat question from the skinny guy.
Okay, Stanless, let me explain this real quick. So, we're all pretty big guys here on the show. And Scott here, Scott Nightstalker, this member that's been talking here, he is by far the skinniest guy on the show. So we have a segment where the skinny guy on the show, he asks the bigger guys on the show personal questions that skinny people have for heavier people. And so we'll take it away, Scott.
The skinny people want to know, when was the last time you used your girth or strength or size to help somebody else? So I'll go to you, Ben.
Good question. When was the last time I used my strength, size, or girth to help somebody? Shit, I don't know. I'm not a very helpful person, I guess. I can't think of anything. I got a bum back. I can't lift shit. I'm not strong anymore. I sit in a chair.
You are girthy.
Very dense.
I am girthy and dense.
Heavier than you look.
You know, I probably sat on something for someone. You know, counterbalance weight. You know, like, hey.
Sat on something for me.
Hey, that was off the record. But anyways.
Ben, you used to use your girth to help me out in, back in high school in the football days.
Yeah, getting you trained and ready to football practice or wrestling practice. No benefit to me. Okay, so sure, why not? That, I guess that would be it.
How about you, Sean?
The last time that I used my enormous girth and strength to help somebody would probably be push starting some single mother's car in the parking lot of Walmart, I guess, a couple months ago.
That was very kind of you.
That's a good one. What about you, Mr. Chris?
There's always an excuse to use your size. I would say I've served as a windscreen. You know, people hide behind me during windstorms. You know, they don't want to get cold or sunscreen, you know, as far as that goes. Or sitting on something. I know, like, you know, a trailer gets stuck on a car. You sit on the back of the car or the truck, and it drops it below the trailer so it can drive away freely. It comes in handy all the time.
There you go.
And Stan, what about you?
I would say that I use my strength, my mental strength, to be open and honest. I love to be honest, like, and take out my ego and to be honest like that with people, because, you know, that then when you do that, like, then you show that you really love somebody. Like, that's how I do it, like that. And that's the best way to knock down your, you know, like the music we play, you know, it's like, we like the music with a lot of testosterone in it, you know, rough rock. But then when you're talking to somebody, when you're honest, so that takes a lot of guts. You know, it tell the truth.
That takes more strength than anything.
I tell the truth as much as I can. Every chance I get, I tell the truth.
Yeah,
that's
great.
So does that cover that?
That's a great answer, Stanley.
Thank you.
Okay. So what we're going to go ahead and do before commercial here, we're going to play another jamming, mind-blowing, eyeball-melting, ear exploding track by our new favorite heavy rock band, Ajammination. Chris, why don't you take us away and announce the track?
This is Rock Bamboo by Ajammination. We'll be right back.
Yeah.
right, welcome back to episode 11 of the Freakishly Amazing Transmission. Thank you for holding through the commercial break. That was a fresh track from Ajammination. When the episode drops, we will have links for all of Ajammination's tracks, as well as a Facebook link to like and follow Stanless Steel. So this drops us into the episode's open forum section where we can talk about anything. Guys, is there anything on your mind that's piquing your interest you want to share with the group? Say it now.
Actually, I had a question for Stan. When you filmed that documentary, Strongman, was that your idea? Did you contact somebody to film that, or did somebody approach you with the idea?
Well, I was on a television show, and I was holding back some airplanes and lifting cars and breaking chains and lifting weight, and Zach Levy, he saw it, and he was like, we kicked it off, and like he said, he goes, man, that's amazing. He goes this should be in a movie. And that's what he had the idea, and then we went forward from there to make a movie on this, and like that. And then we're going to make a new movie. It's going to be The Greatest Feats of Strength. And I'm going to narrate it and explain them all. And like that, they're like, when you lift a sledgehammer, like, that's a sledgehammer, it's 12 pounds. I added 1 pound, that's 13. Now you start from level and you pick it up. That's one, two, three. I did it like 10 times in a row. I got a lot of these things that I've done on video. We're gonna put this all together like that. We're gonna talk about different things, and you'll be a part of the thing. Don't you worry, Sean. You will. We're gonna show the world.
Yes, we will. Yeah, we would love to be able to follow you through that.
Yeah.
It's gonna be awesome. So you still have a good, daily, conversational relationship with Mr. Levy?
Oh yeah, we're friends all the time. Talk all the time.
Was his film, it had a great success here, a couple years ago, which ironically was a few years after it dropped. Were you surprised in the later success of it? I mean, did you notice that around 2013, it started to pick up a bunch of steam?
Yeah, that I don't know, because I'm so involved with different things, and so I kind of didn't pay too much of attention, but I'm glad that, we get such a good positive response from it, And but then again, that comes to being, the person you think you ought to be, try to do what's right, it's you're better off being a good guy than, no matter what. You're better off doing things the right way. Always better to do things the right way. You can win. It's great to win. Just don't cheat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good.
Now, Stan, I'm a big fan of your documentary. And when I was watching, I was kind of curious on what motivated you to become a strongman. Like, did you have any particular person you followed or liked when you were younger that you wanted to be like?
The strongman that I liked a lot was the Mighty Atom. He could actually bite through a nail with his teeth. With his teeth, he could bite through a nail. And his protege is Slim the Hammer Man. Slim the Hammer Man, me and him are friends all the time. I'd like to get sometime we could call Slim up and get him on the show too.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah, as well as we could put Lenny on there, Lenny Molinari, and that drummer, Joe Nivola, my favorite drummer. And Joe also is a spinner, and man, does he spin them sticks like crazy. And I was friends also with Jack Walsh. He was another strongman. Very incredible strongman, too. Like that, he died. Jack and I used to live together. And we were different types of strongmen, though. He was a little different than I was.
Yeah.
But we were great friends. This is all we used to do, was think about power and stuff, Jack was a really nice, he was a really nice guy. And he was my best friend, Jack. He was the one that taught me the finger lift. Jack says, he goes, Stanley, you got to do some things that I do. And I go, well, I don't do those things. I can't be it. You're you. I'm me. And he goes, and then he goes, because you gotta do the finger lift. So a lot of guys, when you do a finger lift, they like to use a tight ring. I didn't like a tight ring because it hurt so bad. It really hurt a lot, so I used a little looser ring. But I wound up getting up there to 600,000 at one week. He's the one. That's the reason why I did that lift, because of Jack. He was real good at it.
What do you think you could lift with one finger right now?
Right now, I think I did 500 the other day. I think I did 500. Yeah.
Wow.
Wow.
So could I bring something up to you, an idea that we may or may not be brewing on, Stan? So we have a friend who has access to a venue in Vancouver, Washington, which is right across the river from Portland, Oregon. And we were thinking about going into the preliminary processes of booking a show. And this guy who appeared on our last episode number 10 of the FatCast, his name is Billy the Fridge. And you might not like the genre of music, but he is a rapper and a professional wrestler, and he weighs 500 pounds. So we were thinking about possibly, now again, this may or may not be in the plans, getting Billy down to do a set and possibly getting you over here to get on stage and be part of the show. And at some point during his set, and if you can somehow get the guys from Ajammination here to do a set too with him, a live concert. This venue can hold 500 people. If you could get there and possibly do a feat of strength, which would be somehow lifting Billy the Fridge because he weighs 500 pounds, I think that would sell out and would be a big success in this area.
Oh, wow. I think so, too.
I mean, doesn't that sound good?
For me to lift with one finger, I got to get like a platform a little bit. It's kind of hard. We could figure it out. It's just sprung on me like that right there.
Yeah.
But I think I could do it,
Or just some kind of lifting his body.
Yeah, it wouldn't have to be one finger. That's a lot of man to lift with one finger.
It's a lot. I love the idea. I love it.
I mean, it would be hard. I mean, we could use budget from the show and ticket sale recovery and everything to get you over here, put you up in a hotel for a couple nights, get the show going on a Saturday night, which we could book it as, and we have a VIP lounge. Everything would be set up, we would have the stage to ourselves, the sound guy, everything is provided, and we just get this guy doing his concert. We'll have an opening act, which would be another musician or maybe a magician or somebody to just add a really crazy, awesome variety show.
Wow, unbelievable. Oh, you get a Ajammination over there. Cool, man.
Yeah, I would absolutely love to have a Ajammination coming.
I think it's something we could work towards. Yeah, absolutely. I think that'd be unbelievable, I got to figure out how to lift that guy up, when I was in Japan, they would make stuff. A lot of times I'd go here and there, and they would make these setups that they had stage tech or an engineer, make those things, to lift the people up, but we could figure something out like that, I hope,
I think that we could do that, definitely.
Guy, 500-pound guy, that's pretty heavy, though. He's pretty big, that guy.
That's a real big guy. But I think you could do something, even if it was just crowd pleasing, easy on you, and so you could perform your music set or your stand up set, which is just question and answer with the crowd or whatever. We could do something, and like I said, we got the venue, we've got the access. I think that we could probably make something happen.
I think we can too, Sean. Absolutely. You get a band like that, the talent, we can do this, and make big noise, and save rock and roll, bring it back, good time, like the good times roll. We can have a good time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, would you like to come see the Pacific Northwest?
Oh, I'd love to see it.
I think that's something then that we should be working on is probably our first day of FatCast promoted event. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to go over with Joe and Lenny,
and let's see what they say if we can get them. And then, you know, we see that it'll call you tomorrow and next day. How's that?
Yeah, yeah. If you guys could work something out. And I think it's something that would be cool. I think it's fresh. I think that the world needs to see more stainless steel. And I think that bringing that to the Pacific Northwest would be a unique, awesome experience for everybody.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. 100%. 100%.
The world needs that.
The world needs it. The world needs it. Let's get this world running and bring this country back to life. Yep. Let's do this. Let's
I do agree.
It. Rock and blow the roof off of that thing. Yeah.
Yep. I think it's a great idea. That's something that we should work towards. Is there anybody else who has anything to say for the open forum? Stan, anybody?
Sure. You want to say hello to Barbara?
Yeah, put Barbara on. Yeah. We'd all love to say hi to her.
Barbara. Hello?
Hi, Barbara.
Hey, Barbara.
Hi, how's everyone?
Excellent.
Good. We're good. Yeah, it's a pleasure to speak with you. You were a very prominent presence on the Strongman documentary, and I'm very happy to have gotten a hold of Stanless and got the chance to say hi to you.
Oh, thank you so much.
A lot of fans over here.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
We're talking to Stan about getting you over to the Pacific Northwest here to do a show, and we'd fly you guys in and put you in a hotel and everything and do a live show and, you know, maybe do a photo shoot for you. You never know.
Wow, that would be wonderful. That's a wonderful idea.
Barbara, tell them how we made the crowds roar. Tell them.
Oh, when we were performing, Stanley and myself, he had a great act. We really did. The more we performed, the better and better we became. Stanley was wonderful.
Roar.
Yes, they did. They loved us. Especially Stan. They loved Stan. Everyone did. Yes.
How could they not?
Exactly. But keep in touch with us. We would love to come out and meet you and perform, definitely.
Okay, sounds good, Barbara.
It'd be wonderful.
Well, it was a pleasure getting to speak to you.
Oh, thank you. Pleasure speaking with you.
And we'll be back in touch with you guys soon if Stanless is back on. We would like to thank Stan formally for coming on to the Freakishly Amazing Transmission. We hope you had a good time.
We did. It was excellent. Thank you.
Oh, it was excellent show.
Okay. So we will stay in touch with you next time. If it's not between now and getting you over for the show, we'd like to talk to you again, Stan, on a show and maybe get your friends on the show that you talked about.
Oh, yes, we can do this, yes.
And we'll have another powerful, center-spirited, earth-flattening experience.
I love it. Let's show them.
Okay, Stan. Thank you so much for coming on. We're going to wrap the show up. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Stanless Steel Pleskun and his wonderful, I don't know, is she your wife yet, or fiance, or girlfriend?
Yeah, she's my girl.
Okay, girlfriend. Stan's wonderful girlfriend, Barbara, from the documentary Strongman. And so thank you for coming on, Stan. We'll talk to you soon. Thank you for being such a great friend to the Freakishly Amazing Transmission. Having said that, we're going to go ahead and wrap up the formal recording of the show. Everybody tune in next week for episode 12. We will update who our special guest will be on our Facebook page. Everybody go like Stanless Steel on Facebook and just do a general Google search of Stanless Steel. Look at his YouTube videos, his feats of strength, and check out Ajammination, which is his heavy rock band. Buy their CD and everything will be good. The world will restore order.
Love it.
Amen.
Okay. Thank you very much, Stan. We'll talk to you soon, buddy. I love you.
All right. Love you too. Bye.
Bye.
Part of the FatCast theme music was provided by podcastthemes.com. View their webpage at podcastthemes.com now.